Said, "What is your name?" And he said, "My name is Secret." Hallelujah. And it's left that way right in your Bibles. If you've got a King James Bible, you can read it. It never does say a word about the meaning of it. It just says his name was Secret. But when you go study that out, you find out the word secret there in the Hebrew ain't what he said. He said, "My name is Wonderful." Hallelujah. And the Bible said in Isaiah the 9th chapter that you shall receive a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son, and you shall call him Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, and an Everlasting Father, and of his kingdom and government there shall be no ending. And they said the government is upon his shoulders. Hallelujah. What a revelation for this hour when everybody's screaming. And I'll tell you something, folks, about these politicians. When you throw that dirt over your head, it comes right back under your feet.
Amen.
Amen. And I'll tell you, they've slung it out now till both sides is getting it on every side, because you can't render evil and get good in return. The only thing you can render and get in return is that a man sow shall he also reap. And brother, if they had sowed goodness, they'd be reaping goodness. But I tell you, in this hour, when they don't even know what to do, when none of them know what to do, when everybody in the media is going haywire trying to figure out what's going to come up next, I've got the word of God in my heart, and it says his kingdom shall have no ending, and the government is upon his shoulders. His shoulders. And I can give you even deeper insight into that and tell you that every one of those men are like a piece on a chessboard. And the Lord is just setting that thing up to fall. Hallelujah. But thanks be to God for the Lord who giveth us the victory this morning and lets us know that there's a people on this earth who know something that everybody else don't know. And everybody don't know it. And that's where the fear comes in. And that's where the timidity comes in. And a sure sign that you don't have the peace of God is that you're one of them out there on the watch for the next bad thing that's going to come up. Oh, my. Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, I will see Rabashan Tavamo.
Hallelujah. For yea, I have set thee upon the watch this day, saith the Lord, as watchmen upon the wall, who shall not hold their peace day nor night. But yea, ye shall not watch for destruction, and you shall not watch for sorrow and for pain. But yea, I've anointed thine eyes to see into another realm and into another dimension, saith the Lord. And where others see failure and calamity, you shall see restoration, and you shall see great harvest, and you shall see an overflow, and you shall see the seed come forth in its fruition, saith the Lord. And yea, do not allow thine ears to be cluttered with other trash that is spoken around thee, but keep thy gate diligently, saith the Lord, and keep thy mouth diligently, saith the Lord, and let nothing go in or come out unless it be words of life, saith the Lord. For yea, I have put this life within thee, and I have put the anointing upon thee, and I've anointed even thine eyes with salve, that thou mayest see into the new dimension of the Spirit. And so this day I admonish thee as my own soldiers upon the wall. Do not be disqualified by the words of doubt and unbelief. Yea, do not be disqualified by visions of failure, but hold up thy torch high and open thy mouth wide this day, saith the Lord, and speak forth those words that I shall put into thy mouth, for they shall be like a hammer that breaketh a rock into pieces, and like a sword that pierces through the enemy. For I have anointed thee and made unto thee flames of fire that shall devour forth and burn up the dross. Ekamahoshai, it shall burn up that has tried to discourage thee, and that has caused thee to be of a despondent spirit and heart. Will I burn up within thee this day, saith the Lord, and thou shalt report unto that wall with great joy, and shall ascend high and take thy place in the Spirit, and shall prophesy the word of the Lord out of thy mouth, and everything around thee shall respond and shall move at the sound of thy voice, saith the Lord God. Hallelujah. Woo, let's praise him this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, Shabbahiah. Woo, Handalabokosiah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Watchmen on the wall. Visionaries. Destiny people. Hallelujah. My God, it all shout out. Hallelujah. And as thou standest upon this wall, saith the Lord, it shall not be long until many others come to join thee. Yea, if thou wilt stand and remain faithful unto thy seal and faithful unto the call. Yea, let not the fire go out, but keep it stirred, saith the Lord. Keep thyself on fire and attentive to my word. Keep thyself on the cutting edge. Keep thyself in keen awareness. Yea, I shall send many more to join thee. Oh, I shall send a people up. Kurabasanda, I have chosen me a people, saith the Lord, and I have crowned that people with my glory, saith God, and yea, my presence shall be unto them as a diadem upon their head, and their countenance shall radiate with my beauty and with my glory, saith the Lord, and ye shall not look upon these people and see what they have been through, but ye shall look upon them and see the glory of the Lord, saith the Lord. And they shall rise and shine in Zion, for yea, the time and even the set time have come to deliver her, saith the Lord. And she shall stand and be qualified, and she shall stand and be glorified, saith God. So this day there is no time to take off. There is no time to get lax. There is no time to slack up. But yea, tighten up thy straps this day, saith the Lord, and man thy post, for ye shall surely see a prevailing of the glory of the Lord in this hour. Hallelujah. Ooh, oh, Shamatai. You can't afford to take off a Sunday. And I don't mean by that leave. I'm talking about take off spiritually. You can't afford to come in here and have an easy day where you don't participate. You got to get in all the way. You got to get in all the way. You got all these, that's the ruin of all these programs. Just holding people in a prison cell where they can't get loose. Oh my God. Brother, it's time to get loose. It's time to shake off them heavy bands. It's time to get the viper off of them. It's time to just fling the thing that's biting you and devouring you, fling it off of you. And bless God, don't go back hunting the fire to get it. Just leave it there. Yeah, but I didn't have time to pray over it. Well, the Lord's going to release you from that today. Even if you hadn't had time to pray over it, throw it off. That's what the Holy Ghost just said. Even if you hadn't had time to do a Bible study on it, throw it off. Even if you hadn't had time to tell me about it or tell somebody else about it, throw it off. Shake it off in the fire. They'll say, well, what shall happen? I'll tell you what will happen. You'll let the glory into the situation. And when you let the glory in, the Lord gets to moving for you. You know it, that thing don't even exist anymore. You know I've held burdens willingly for days on end because I said, well, I haven't had time to pray about that. How can I shake that off? I haven't had time. It has ever done. I haven't had time to bring it to the Lord. But I hear the Lord say this morning, I don't care if you haven't brought it to me. Let it go. Turn the thing loose and let it go to God. Can you say praise the Lord? Well, it just happened and I hadn't had time to get my thoughts together. Oh, let it go. Oh, but I just found out about it. I hadn't had time to worry over it yet. That's all right. Let it go. Hallelujah. Turn the thing loose unto God this morning. Before you have time to worry over it. Before you have time to consider how it's going to turn out. Let the Lord have it. I found one thing, folks, the deeper you get in the glory, the faster you have to move. I said the deeper you get in the glory, the faster you have to move. You don't have all this time to sit around and wonder what the outcome is going to be. You just have to jump in the middle of what God's doing, believing everything's going to work out. Yeah, but what if, I didn't do the works I was supposed to do. I got to have a part in, not in the glory, you know. You just let go and let God. And sometimes, you know, you get let go in the river and you get worried because you see that person hanging on to that branch trying to keep afloat. And here you let go. So you're floating down the river shouting the praise of God. Then you turn back and see your brother holding on to that branch. And you're tempted to try to go back and get him and save him. Hello? But you can't fight the current once you give way to it. Ooh, you can't fight it. It's too late. You've already let go in God. Somebody said, well, what's going to happen? Well, he's going to realize in a little bit. that he might as well let go too.
Glory to God.
And when he lets go, it won't be but a few more minutes. He'll catch up right where you're at. Well, glory. He'll be right there where you're at. Let go. Quit trying to. Some of y'all, you're in people's businesses too much. You're trying to work everybody else's life out. You need to let go and float a while this morning. It don't matter what you tell people. They're going to do what they want to anyhow. You can tell them till the sky falls, brother. And grown people's going to do what grown people wants to do. Sometimes I'm telling them, and even while I'm telling them on the phone, I can hear them put the wall up. They ain't going to listen to me. I'll say, now they love what the Word says. And before I even finish the scripture, they're already giving me a reason why that won't work. So I just quit talking. That's right. I just quit talking. And they go on 10, 15 more minutes about what they've got to do. And I just let them talk. And when I don't say no more, they'll say, well, I guess I'll go. And I say, well, go ahead. But other people called me. And they called me for the sole purpose of hearing what the Holy Ghost has to say. And brother, in 10 minutes, I can have them pray through to the victory because I'll prophesy to them. Amen. So you people that are trying to handle everything, let it go this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. That's what the Holy Ghost is saying to God. Let go of everything. Let it go in the river. Can you say praise the Lord? Well, glory to God. We got JJ in here still.
Yes.
There he is. Stand up, JJ. He's a birthday boy today. So we got to sing to him. It's his birthday today. Amen. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Go ahead and turn to Joel 2. I tell you, this message today came to me in the most peculiar way that's never come before. I had a dream Friday. I guess it was between early Friday night and Saturday morning. And I dreamed that Pastor had scooted his chair all the way over to that corner. And he was getting over and he was laughing. And he was laughing. And he was trying to get up to leave. It's like he had to go somewhere in haste. But he was laughing. And the door was over to him. And all he could say was, this is that. This is that. This is that. And then he finally was able to get up and he said, I have to go in haste. I have somewhere to travel too quickly. And he grabbed a suitcase and he went out. And then so everybody was like, well, who's going to speak? Because the church was full and it was time for service. And Chris comes off the drums and laughs and he said, Megan, you got this revelation on Joel, and Matt said, it's your turn to speak. And that's how I got this decision. It was from a dream. And we know that at the end of Joel 2, it says that old men will see visions and young men will dream dreams. And this is that. All that word that's coming forth about the glory, it's that time. It's now time. Hallelujah. And then I was just studying, and I wasn't even thinking about Ruth Ward Heflin, and I actually went to look up some words in the Strong while I was studying last night, And I happened to see Mom's Glory book sitting there on the coffee table. And the Lord said, turn to page 64. And when I opened it up, she was talking about the people that with this glory, you got to have your shoes and your feet ready to go quickly to foreign lands. You see, with Ruth Ward Heflin and everything that she didn't sit there and ponder and worry of where she was. She got the word, and before, many times before she could even pray about it, she went and she had her suitcase ready. And I think that's like starting with the pastor. He's our leader. And you see, with us, is to have our bags ready for whatever the Lord wants us to do. We might physically be going to a place, or yet we might travel in the spirit. The Lord says that when we dance, you see, Wednesday, this we were having worship, and then this move of dancing. I was trying to run the sound booth all by myself, and I was trying to focus on the camera and that, and I don't even know if I got everything, because this spirit of dancing just came upon me, and I danced all across that sound booth last on Wednesday night, and I noticed that I looked out, and other people were dancing. And there was some glory that was coming there. And when I was studying there, I found this old notebook that I don't even know where I found it. And when I was looking in there, that's when I had written, and it was in 2013, I had written this dream. And in this dream, I was sitting up in the sound booth, and at the time, there was a lie going on in my leg. This ringworm had gotten my leg, and it was all infected. And while I was sitting there, one of the saints that used to come to church, that he's already passed away, he came up behind me and laid his hands on my leg and was speaking forth the now word. And he came out and he started pacing the pews. And I said, what are you doing? And he said, I'm preparing the way and I'm serving up the meat. And as he was doing that, out on the stage, there came some strong men, and they were carrying this big grandbaby piano and moved the drums out of the way and put the piano right there. And then my Granny Edwards came out and she started playing on the piano. And as she started playing on the piano, some other clouds of witnesses started coming through the windows. And they came in and they started singing the song, and I didn't even realize they were singing the song that's called We Prepare the Way of the Lord. And they were saying, Brother Lindsay, I've only seen pictures of him. I've never even met him. But he said, he introduced himself to me. And he said, we're preparing the way, the place, and the path for the glory to come. And after he said that, here comes Aunt Barbara and Aunt Shirley, and see, this is where they ever started coming to our church. And they came out and they started dancing with Aunt Weta. And she's one of Papa's sisters. And they were shouting and dancing all around the front. And then Aunt Barbara and Aunt Shirley, they and Hayes, they said they had to go. But they thanked Granny for inviting them to come to dance because they needed some relief in their life. And we know that now, presently, they have come because they've received some relief in their life at this new word. And she looked up at me as I was reading this, because I forgot a lot of that dream. And she looked up at me and she said, Megan, it's going to be all right. I'm all in control. This glory is coming in. We're just welcoming it in. And since that time, since 2013, it's now been about 3 years left for that vision. Because I actually had that vision in May around this time. The Lord has just made the glory come deeper and more. Revelations come deeper, and there's a joy that has to overtake you. You can't worry and you can't fret about it. And it says in Joel 2, starting verse 1, it says, blow a trumpet in Zion, sound an alarm on my holy mountain, let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming, it is near. A day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, like blackness, there is spread over upon the mountains a great and powerful people. Their life has never been before, nor will be again after them through the years of all generations. You know, I started thinking about that, and I was thinking, you know, that darkness and gloominess, it cannot be like what we're picturing there. It cannot be a terrible thing, because the day of the Lord is not a terrible thing. It's a wonderful thing. Just like
the where it said he was talking about Samson, he said my name is secret, and really it meant wonderful. So I looked up some of those words, and all that the darkness meant is that it's a hidden thing. And the gloominess is just is the sunset. And we know that when midnight time comes, it's a changing of a day. And it's a causing, you see, that joy comes in the morning. So all it is when the day of the Lord is coming, it's a cause of a change that comes. In Song of Solomon 2, where it says that the winter has passed and the springtime has come. The springtime has come. And you see, he's causing the natural. Everything is rebirthing in the natural. And right now, everything is rebirthing in the spirit. And you have to let it overtake you. You have to let all the positive of this mindset to overtake you. You know, sometimes it concerns me or worries me when I see some friends of mine that started to get the kingdom revelation and they wanted to walk in it, but they only went so far. And now I see them and they look so depressed. They look so terrible. They don't even look like themselves, but it's just a mindset. Mom and I were praying over one of my friends last night that she saw her, and she's like, my God, she doesn't even look like herself. We prayed for the new mindset, and the Holy Spirit came upon us, and we were doing that. And you see, the Lord has caused us to prophesy. We can speak and change all the situation without anybody even knowing it. Yeah. You know, over and over, we listen to Bill Winston, and he has a phrase that he says that favor ain't fair. And it's really not. You see, when you're upon this people, the Lord will cause small things, but even greater things. He's caused us to have greater things. I loved it when Pastor said, I believe he said it last Wednesday, where he said that to allow yourselves to get into the now and not to worry or fear of the unknown, but to allow the prophecies of greater things to come. Hallelujah. And so you see, with that, we have to allow ourselves to do that. You know, the Lord shows me a lot of times in little things, but I'm ready for the greater things. There was a time when we went last weekend, we took a day off, Mom and I, and we went to Disney and had a wonderful time, and then we celebrated JJ's party early. And just speaking of a little thing that the Lord will do, is it was funny, but I was needing a new water bottle for work, and I just didn't have time to go to the store. And I saw that there was a drawing. They had Teacher Appreciation Week, and we were allowed to put our name in one time for a drawing. And one of the things was a bag, and it had a beach towel, and it had a very nice water bottle in that little bag. And I was like, well, Lord, that would just be awesome if I just get that. That way I don't even have to worry about going to the store. And I was gone that weekend. And when I come back, I was just teaching my class away, and I get a knock at the door, and the math coach is there. She said, well, while you were gone Friday, you won this bag. And it was the exact one. And so I was like, well, praise the Lord, I don't have to buy that water bottle. But you see, that's just something small. The Lord's got great things, and they're just going to overtake you, just like this day of the Lord in Joel 2. And it says that fire devours them. Before them and behind them, a flame burns. The land is like the Garden of Eden before them, but behind them a desolate wilderness, and nothing escapes them. We know that the Garden of Eden is God's delight. He brought them back to his original identity, his original intent. Because when Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, they were glorified bodies. They were bodies of light. And that's what he's causing us to come back into. That no disease and no burden can overtake us like the waves of the sea. We won't have fear. You know, when Jesus was on the ship with the disciples, they had great fear come upon them. Because they didn't have the faith, the level of faith and the understanding when that storm came. And they woke him up. And honestly, I think Jesus was annoyed because he's like, hello, you can do this. I've given you all power. And all he said real gently was, peace be still, and the waves calm. And that's the thing is we don't have to rely on Jesus to do it for us. We can speak it for it. I was listening this morning, I can't even remember who it was, but he was talking about that our blessing is calling out to us. But how often do you call forth your blessing to work, that your angels are just waiting there just to go and message and go here and go forth and do? because you have the authority to speak forth change. And you see, when it's talking about here, when his people gather together in Revelation, it causes the glory to flood in, restoring everything to God's original intent. Do not ask yourselves of the desolate and the despair going on among the people, among the nation, or even yourself. This is a time and place for rejoicing. For I am taking charge, and I am in control of everything. And my people, that's what the Lord told me to write down, my people are not in desolate and despairing in a dry land. They are plowing the fields, planting the seed, and seeing a quick, abundant harvest. They are in the land rejoicing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you see, the Lord also reminded me of two visions that I had before when I was starting to get this understanding of what the grace is and what the mercy of God is and what these mysteries are. And the first one was he showed me a revelation of what it means to have grace and what it means to have condemnation. And in this dream, I saw this deep pit. And down in the bottom, there were all these people. And they were dressed up like Roman soldiers. And across their breastplate was written in big, bold letters, condemnation. And these people were crawling over everyone. It was a pit full of blood. And they were fighting against each other. And then I noticed that one of them looked up. And he started to reach his hand up. And I was wondering what he was looking at. And then I realized that there were all these people that were up above that pit. And they were standing on this really bright green grassy ledge. Like, it would remind me of like Ireland, of how green it was. And they were looking and they were reaching. They weren't looking down, but they were reaching. And as soon as that man reached up his hands, it was like his hands stretched up to their hands. And he went up and he floated on top of that ledge. And as soon as he hit that ledge, his body went poof, and he melted out like the Wicked Witch of the West or the Wizard of Oz. And up came him, and he was in a linen ephod. And then as he looked all around, there were people dancing and rejoicing, and they were playing upon the instruments. And there was a glory that was all around. You could see it. It was just vibrant everywhere. And he just joined them, and they went on rejoicing. And that's the Lord said, that's my grace. That's my grace, what it does. It changes the whole mindset. And the other one he reminded me of happened to me while I was sitting right over there during a prayer meeting. And pastor said, somebody's got a vision and you're seeing a rock. And I was having this vision that I was laying in this dry, clay, cracked desert and all I could see was a rock. And then the Lord showed me the rest of it. As I looked at the rock, he said, get up. And when I got up, I realized that I was not myself, but I was a gazelle. And he said, go leaping. So I went leaping, and it went from a dry, cracked desert to a very grassy, very hilly area. And I kept going up on the mountains. You know, he makes our feet like hinds feet. And I kept going up in the mountains. And I got to a place, and there was a place where all these other gazelles were, but I realized that I was just seeing the symbolism that we were gazelles, but we were the saints of the Lord. And in there was this wonderful waterfalls surrounded. That reminded me of Niagara Falls. And it was the glory exuberating out. There was light and rainbows coming out. And he said, now jump in there. And I was like, Lord, that's a long way down there. He said, jump in there. And it's like, as soon as I jump in there and I hit that water, it would like bounce me back up. And that's what the glory in the river does, is you don't sink to the bottom and drown. It rises you up with your new mindset. It makes you completely whole. And as I continued with this vision, I was looking and it was more of a lake and a river. And I was thinking of that verse that when you go in the rivers that are ankle deep and then rivers that are waist deep and then rivers that are into swimming. And it was one of my cousins that we have been believing for, and we are speaking that he is coming out of all of it. And he was dressed completely in black, and his hair was long and black, and he had long black facial hair. And we were singing a song, and he said, Megan, why didn't you tell me about this Why didn't you tell me that this was the truth of the Lord? My eyes have had a veil on it. And I said, all you gotta do is dip down in that water. And as soon as he dipped down in that water, he came leaping out of it. And he was all cleaned up and dressed in a purple suit. And next thing I know, I saw him right here in this church. And he was the youth leader. And all of the youth was up and they were praising. Because you see, that's one concern that the Lord has put on my heart to pray about. But instead, I have become thanking the Lord. Because I feel like sometimes this younger generation does not have the revelation or the zeal that we want to have, but it's just going to overtake them.
Yeah.
You know, my mom had a dream that all the kids were back in the children's church. And all of a sudden, you know, it's JJ's birthday. He started shouting and he started praying for all the kids back there. And they all started speaking in other tongues. And you see, that's what it is with this word of joy and peace as within this day of the Lord. It's this is that. It's going to overtake. But we have to look at it as it is now. We have to thank the Lord. I'm about finished with the Now Zone with Rick Manis. And he was talking in one of the later chapters that all the time he was the best one to get radical with his faith and to speak it forth. But he always thought of it as the future. And he went from naming and claiming it to thanking the Lord. Because he said the Lord showed him that when we thank the Lord, that's when the now comes and it overtakes us.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Continuing in verse 4, and their appearance is like the appearance of horses. And we know a horse, that is a symbol of the horsemen. It's a symbol of consulting together and advising together and to separate and to stretch out. And a horse is also a representation of a messenger. And like war horses, they run. And with the rumbling of chariots, they leap on the tops of the mountains.
Yeah.
Like the crackling of a flame of fire, devouring the stubble. You know, the Lord, he burns away all the old and refines us as gold and makes us new. And like a powerful army drawn up for battle, before them, peoples are in anguish. All faces grow pale. Like warriors, they charge. Like soldiers, they scale the wall. They march each on his way. They do not swerve from their paths. They do not jostle one another. Each marches in his path. They burst through the weapons and are not halted. They leap upon the city. They run upon the walls. They climb up into the houses and they enter through the windows like a thief. And the earth quakes before them and the heavens tremble. The sun and the moon are darkened and the stars withdraw their shining. The Lord utters his voice before his army, for his camp is exceedingly great. He who executes his word is powerful, for the day of the Lord is great and very awesome.
Yeah.
Who can endure it? Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He relents over disaster. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, consecrate a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Consecrate the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, even the nursing infants. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber.
Yeah.
And you see the Lord's saying there is a gathering of all levels of faith. The children are the virgin saints. The nursing infants are those that are on the milk cord. They haven't gotten the full revelation yet. And the bride herself, she's the meat saint. And she's coming with that. And we are the bride. And we have to rise up. And we have to gather together. You see, the word is going beyond just the remnant. There's more coming. There's a prophecy said Wednesday night that said, if those that were the remnant will no longer come, the Lord will send a new one. You see, the Lord's not going to let this word die out. This is beyond word. We have the revelation of the kingdom word, and we have the spirit together, and it's a powerful force. And there's some people that don't like like it, because when you come into it fully, you have to change. And there's a lot of people that don't want to change. There were times in my life when I started getting revelation of this word. I said, oh, I'm going to do that. Okay, all right, all right. And I was like, and the, one of the hardest things was to realize that I did not have a mansion up in the sky somewhere.
That's right.
And I was the mansion. Yeah, and the first time the pastor said that, I was like, he probably got a look for me like, I have to check out that scripture, all right. And then I realized, yeah, we are.
Yeah,
and then the first, next revelation was when I realized that there were glorified bodies before there were earthly bodies.
Right.
And that was, I was like, what? There's this first with that. But you know that the, when we let the word and the spirit overtake us, he clears off all the cobwebs, all the veils that are there of our mind. I wish I could remember all of it. But Frank had sent me this, there's this website called printing.net, and it has this guy, his name is Ray Printing. He has a lot of revelation of the kingdom of God, and he posted a lot of times. And he sent me one about the sin of water. And I had spoken that before, but I didn't realize that there was a whole bunch about Joel 2 in there. And at the end, him and his wife had written this poem called The Sin of Water. And it was talking about the sin of water overtakes my heart, and it causes me to have a new mindset. And it kept talking about being overwhelmed by joy as all carnality goes away. And it causes me to dance and to rejoice. Hallelujah. That's what the Lord is causing us to do. And it says, fear not, you beast of the field, is in verse 22. For the pastures of the wilderness are green, and the tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and the vine give their full yield. Be glad, O children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For he has given the early rain for your vindication, and he has poured down for you abundant rain, the early and the latter rain as before. And he said, when I was reading that, he said that the early rain was a symbol of the sound of the Lord, that the sound of the Lord along with the river working together is what washes and purifies the whole mind of Christ within you. And you shall eat plenty in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never again be put to shame. And you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and there is none else. And my people shall never again be put to shame. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh, that your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions. Even on the male and the female servants in those days, I will pour in my spirit. What he's saying is that everybody is able to prophesy. Everybody is allowed to see visions. Everyone is allowed to see dreams. But you have to allow yourself to be keen into the spirit to see these things. And I will show wonders in heavens and on earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke. And the sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Or in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there shall be those who escape, as the Lord has said, and among the survivors shall be those whom the Lord calls. What that's just saying is, before you fully become a son, realize that you're a son of God. A lot of times it takes you to be to the very bottom before you can come to the very up. Hallelujah. But in this day, in this joy, it's just going to overtake you completely. Hallelujah. I'm going to read a little bit in Acts 2, but I'm going to read out of the Message because I like how it says it. And it said, when the feast of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind, a gale force. That's the strongest wind, that's like the hurricane winds. And no one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building. Then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks, and they started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. This made me think of that scene where, in the book of Monkeys and Dragons, when Michelle O'Donnell had gone to that prayer meeting, and she was first being introduced to people that had some kingdom revelation. And while she was sitting there praying, the curtain started coming up, and she was amazed by it, all the people. Or just happens all the time. But you see, that's what it is a miraculous. is overtaken us when we allow the spirit to take complete control, because you are a spirit, just having an earthly experience, not the other way around. When we allow the spirit to fully overtake us, allow ourselves to be connected to the heavens, that is where the glory just comes in, and it fulfills everything that we want in our lives and beyond that. It says in Ephesians 3 that he will do exceedingly and above all we shall ask or think. There, and see, that's what the Lord wants us to see, that he has great things. Just like with that small thing, I just wanted that water bottle. But see, the Lord has got this greatness upon me, and he's got greatness upon you that we may not even be able to fathom yet. But it is a now time. Don't be surprised if you don't walk into something new 10 minutes from now. That the Lord's been wanting you to get freer in the spirit. The Lord's been wanting you to dance. The Lord's been wanting you to speak in tongues. And you've been having fear of control in your life. But the Lord wants you to be free. You see, I was listening this morning, and this guy was preaching on the rest in you. And he said, for you to have the rest, you have to have restoration. Well, when you accept the full restoration of the mind, all things that are promised in the word will manifest in you. And you just need to accept it and quit worrying about this up here. Because that's what the Lord kept saying. Don't worry. You don't have time to pray over it. It's just going to overtake you. The glory is just going to flood in like a cloud, like a river, overtaking you. And it says that there were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. When they heard the sound, they came on the run. Then when they heard one after another, their own mother tongues being spoken, they were thunderstruck. They couldn't for the life of them figure out what was going on, and kept saying, aren't those all good Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother tongues? Parthians, Medians, and Elamites, visitors from Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, immigrants from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, even Cretans and Arabs. They're speaking our languages, describing God's mighty works. Their heads were spinning. They couldn't make head or tail of any of it. They talked back and forth, confused. What's going on here? Others joke they're drunk on cheap wine. This makes me think. I was reading one time of this missionary, and she was in one of those Middle Eastern countries. And the Lord told her to go into this bar, and that there would be this room at the back of the bar where she could pray. And she was praying back there, and she felt a tongue come upon her. But she just was praising and worshiping the Lord. And when she was there, this man from a totally different country, he had started wondering about Jesus and stuff. He had heard some friends, and he was not used to being around some Christians. And he heard the sound, and he had to stop. And they were like, what are you doing, dude? And he goes back there, and he listens. And it's his mother tongue. And he said, I didn't know anybody spoke that tongue around here. That's my country, is thousands of miles away. And she was praising the Lord and stuff. And it said right there that he came to himself. And he realized who Jesus was. And right then and there, he gave his life to the Lord and became a Christian and believer in Christ. And you see, that's what these people were like. They couldn't believe that the glory could manifest. But we've got to come to a point that we can believe in miracles that will happen daily in our lives. That it's, the miraculous is going to be the ordinary, not the extraordinary. Because that's what God has caused us to walk in when it's into this glory. And then this part says, then when Peter stood up and, backed by the other 11, spoke out with bold urgency, fellow Jews, all of you who are visiting Jerusalem, listen carefully and get the story straight. These people aren't drunk, as some of you suspect. They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9:00 in the morning. This is what the prophet Joel announced would happen. In the last days, God said, I will pour out of my spirit on every kind of people. and your sons will prophesy, and also your daughters. Your young men will see visions, your old men dream dreams. When the time comes, I'll pour out my spirit on those who serve me, men and women both, and they'll prophesy. I'll set wonders in the sky above and signs on the earth below. Blood and fire and billowing smoke, the sun turning black and the moon blood red. Before the day of the Lord arrives, the day tremendous and marvelous, and whoever calls out for help to me, God will be saved. Fellow Israelites, listen carefully to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man thoroughly accredited by God to you, the miracles and wonders and signs that God did through him are common knowledge. This Jesus, following the delicate and well thought out plans of God, was betrayed by men who took the law into their own hands and was handed over to you, and you pinned him to a cross and killed him. But God untied the death ropes and raised him up. Death was no match for him. David said it all. I saw God before me for all time. Nothing can shake me. He's right by my side. I'm glad from the inside out, ecstatic. I've pitched my tent in the land of hope. I know you'll never dump me in Hades. I'll never even smell the stench of death. You got my feet on the life path. With your face shining joy, sun joy all around. Dear friends, let me be completely frank with you. Our ancestor David is dead and buried. His tomb is in plain sight today. But being also a prophet and knowing that God has solemnly sworn that a descendant of his would rule this kingdom seen far ahead, he talked of the resurrection of the Messiah. No trip to Hades, no stench of death. This Jesus God raised up, and every one of us here is a witness to it. Then raised to the height of the right hand of God, and receiving the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father, he poured out the Spirit he has just received. This is what you see and hear, for David himself did not ascend to heaven, but he did say, God said to my master, sit at my right hand, until I make your enemies a stool for your resting your feet. And all of Israel then know this, there's no room for doubt. God made him master and Messiah, this Jesus whom you killed on a cross. Cut to the quick, those who were listening, they're listening, ask Peter and the other apostles, brothers, so now what do we do? And Peter said, change your life. Time, turn to God and be baptized, each of you in the name of Jesus Christ, so your sins are forgiven. Receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is targeted to you and your children, but also to all who are far away, whomever, in fact, our God Master invites. And he went on in this vein for a long time, urging them over and over, get out while you can. Get out of this sick and stupid culture. The day about 3,000 took him at his word, were baptized and were signed up, and they committed themselves to the teaching of the apostles, the life together, the common meal and the prayers. And this is the part that I want you to see about the gathering here. And it said everyone around was in awe. All those wonders and signs done through the apostles. And all the believers lived in a wonderful harmony, holding everything in common. They sold whatever they owned and pooled their resources so that each person's need was met. They followed a daily discipline of worship in the temple, followed by meals at home. Every meal a celebration, exuberant and joyful, as they praised God. People in general liked what they saw. Every day their number grew as God added those who were saved. And you see, that's what it is when we praise God, and we let this worship, and we let this story, and we let this new word not just stay here in this physical building, but to go out into our hearts. You see, they gathered together, and they helped everyone in need. That's what it is as a congregation, that when you see your fellow brethren in need, that you do there. You know, the Lord has really been working with me that sometimes you don't mean to doubt, but when you hear this crazy thought in your head of something that you need to do, you're like, should I really do it? But you see, that's what the Lord is wanting us to do. And here lately, in the past week, he told me to plant seeds into three people's lives. And so I was like, well, I just need to do it. So I went ahead and did it. And I've already gotten two phone calls. And they said, you don't know how much I needed it, but I will take that and you be blessed. And that's what the Lord wants us to do, is that when we see our brethren lead, and sometimes we don't see it, but the Lord tells us, Because someone on the outside could look like they got it all together, but on the inside be rotting. Because they don't have the knowledge and the mindset. But that's what the Lord is causing us to do, is that when we see our brother in need, it might be in need of revelation, that we just speak forth and we prophesy and we say the day of the Lord has come, that this is that the joy is overtaking them, that we allow it to happen, and then we will see change. That's the thing, is you have to allow change and not a habit to always form in your life. That's the hardest part, is that change. You have to let this break away. All that old tradition break away, because that's religion and that's doctrine and that's death. It says that the letter killeth, but the spirit brings life. Hallelujah. He blessed the day.